Welcome to Your Voice. I'm Julia Lilkendee. Today, Senator Robert Ortt is here to fill us in on what's happening in the New York State Senate. How are you, Senator?
I'm good. How are you?
Pretty good. So, budget hearings have started. Everything seems to be on a roll. You were given a committee to chair. But first, I want to talk about Barnette Burton.
Sure.
You brought her here when you and your colleagues remembered 13 people who died in the November snowstorm. Let's take a look.
Sure.
I would like to personally welcome one of my constituents, Niagara Falls resident, Ms. Barnette Burton. Barnette got on a train this morning at 6:30 to join us here, and she will turn around and take a six-hour train ride home. The reason she's here, of course, is to honor her son, Delancey Scott, who we lost in November storm. Delancey was a veteran of the New York Army National Guard and leaves behind a daughter.
She lives in Columbus, so she couldn't make it.
Okay.
So I'm here representing everybody.
The whole family.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I know he's smiling down and he knows you're here, and I appreciate you for making the trip.
Thank you.
She mentioned to me that Delancey passed away alone, and she wanted to be here today so that in a small way she would be with him here as we recognize his life and legacy. And so I want to thank you for coming, and I hope that our actions today will not only recognize those we lost, not just in Niagara County, but across Western New York, but also bring some closure, help with the grieving process, and bring some level of absolution.
And I almost couldn't make it because I didn't have the funds. So, and then your office called and said, you guys will do it and bring me here. So here I am.
Here you are.
Yes, I'm so happy and I appreciate it. And you're helping me through my grieving process so much. You just don't know.
Well, that's if we can help out in a little way with your grieving, that's certainly great to hear that.
So she came to Albany on a day where we were supposed to get a storm
here. Yeah.
And session was moved up early, and I understand that she just made it in time.
She did. You know, it was one of these, it was put together at the last second. We actually spoke to her on a Friday before Monday session. And as you noted, you know, her son was lost in the November storm. He actually froze to death, unfortunately. And so we put this together on a Friday. You know, we got the tickets. She was all set to go. And then, of course, Sunday night, as I'm driving down, I'm hearing all these reports of this horrible snowstorm moving into the Albany area. And, of course, you're thinking of the irony of I'm bringing a woman down who lost her son in a snowstorm into a snowstorm, you know, to recognize her. And we didn't know if she was going to make it on time. And she got here just in the nick of time. We actually were able to delay a little bit the resolution so that she could be here on time to be here, because I know how important it was really to her and to her family. And it was kind of a special, certainly a special day for me, but obviously a special day for her as well.
Yeah, I mean, we just heard her say how much it meant to her, and it was definitely a generous offer. But why did it mean so much to you that she was here physically?
Well, you know, I mean, obviously her son was a veteran, and that sort of struck a chord with me. He was the only person in my district that, you know, was lost during the storm. But it really was, it meant a lot to her. And I know if that was me or if that was my mom or if that was any mom, you know, that's a special moment. She wanted to be here. As she told me, you know, she wasn't there when her son passed away. And it meant a lot for her to be here when we recognized him. And so I think in that regard, it was important for me to get her here. And it was a small thing to do to get her, you know, to pay for the tickets and that. That was not a big deal to see how much it meant to her when she was here. Mm-hmm. So that made it all worth it for sure.
Did she enjoy the Capitol?
She did. She did. I mean, she told me, she said, I never thought I'd be here in my whole life, you know. And I said, well, me neither, up until a few weeks ago. But, you know, she was, obviously it was a kind of a whirlwind. She got in, went right to the floor. And then after that, she was in my office for a little bit and got to meet my staff and kind of walk around the Capitol, you know, on the elevators with me and that kind of thing. So she, like I said, you know, at the end of the day, it was a solemn event, a solemn thing, recognizing her son who was lost. But as she said, and this meant a lot to me, you know, she said it helped her through her grieving process a little bit. And I think if you can do that, that's probably that's as big of a thing as the Senate probably does on any given day.
Mm-hmm.
And so that was made it all worthwhile, and I knew that it was the right thing to do. So,
right. you were chosen to be the Mental Health and Developmental Disabilities Chairman.
Mm-hmm.
What do you think about being given that?
Sure. Well, it's a great responsibility. I think anytime you're named a chairman of a committee, it's an incredible responsibility, especially as a freshman senator. Mental health, there's a lot of folks there who depend on the chairman of the Mental Health Committee to advocate for them, to make sure they're getting the resources, to just give a voice to people in another sense that don't have a voice. When you talk about people with developmental disabilities, when you talk about people who have mental health issues, particularly to me, you think about veterans who are coming back from their wars in Iraq and Afghanistan, who are being discharged, who have PTSD and who have mental health issues as a result of their deployments. And that's something I'm going to work very closely with Senator Tom Croce, who's the veterans chairman. We want to work together to try to certainly advocate not only for those folks, but make sure they have the resources, make sure they have access to programs, and that, whether it's research or whatever might be going on, I think we're still learning how to address some of these symptoms and these issues that these soldiers are bringing back. And a lot of times these are young folks, young men, young women, who their whole lives are ahead of them, and we want to make sure they can be fully functioning members of society. So that's a big issue for me. Folks with developmental disabilities certainly need a strong voice here in Albany, and I'm honored and privileged to be able to be that person.
So the public budget hearing, what day is that?
That is the 27th.
Okay.
It was rescheduled because of the weather events, yeah.
Right. So our viewers can watch it on Channel 83, also on nysenate.gov.
Great. Yeah, and I encourage them too. I mean, any of the public hearings, because these are very important. A lot of times these don't get the press coverage that some other things get, but these are very important as the budget process goes forward.
Right, and they can reach out to you with any ideas that they have.
Absolutely. I've been meeting, as you can imagine, I've been meeting with a lot of mental health providers, folks that deal in this field with folks with disabilities, people who deal with veterans that have PTSD issues, and we'll continue to meet with them. And obviously, if there's constituents of mine who are watching that want to reach out to me, I encourage you to do so.
Okay. Now I want to talk to you about the other legislative body. Speaker Sheldon Silver resigned as Speaker mm-hmm. last night. How has this impacted state government?
Well, it certainly caused a lot of chaos in the first month. Obviously the allegations are very troubling. And I think it just further impairs the trust between the people of New York and their state government when you see something like this, especially from the speaker, somebody, a senior leadership position, who's been the speaker for a very long time, obviously. Mm-hmm. But I think it's an opportunity as well. I always try to look at bad things even as opportunities. It's an opportunity for the Assembly to do the right thing, and I give credit to certainly the Assembly Republicans like Jane Corwin and Steve Hawley, as well as ultimately the Assembly Democrats who made the decision to ask Speaker Silver to step aside, and to, it's an opportunity for new leadership to come in. And it's also an opportunity, I think, for us, both in the Senate and the Assembly, to enact some meaningful reforms to how state government works. One thing that we've done in the Senate for the past several years, we already have term limits on leadership positions and chairman positions. That's internal to our own rules. Mm-hmm. But I think we have an opportunity to maybe pass legislation with the Senate or with the Assembly that makes that, law that no one in the Assembly or Senate can serve in a leadership position longer than a certain amount of time, term limit that. Mm-hmm. And I think that'll be a real positive for voters, for constituents in New York, and I think it goes to the opportunity we have to make some real reforms and increase transparency in our state government, which I think is needed.
So he was the speaker for 21 years.
21 years.
And now facing a 5-count federal corruption charge.
Correct. Yeah, it's like I said, it's something that you certainly don't want to deal with. It brings, I think, a lot of some discredit. And further tarnishes, I think, the image of state government. But again, at some point, this is an opportunity for us to make needed changes, not just from an optic standpoint, but real reforms that I think change the way state government functions, especially the leadership positions, to hopefully decrease these things in the future.
The governor just said that he wanted you to pass these ethics reforms, or he was going to hold up the budget. What do you think about that?
Well, I certainly am behind ethics reforms and real meaningful reforms, not just reforms that look good in the newspaper, but real reforms. And again, we've done that in the Senate. I do think the governor's a little late to the party in this. I mean, we had Moreland, and then Moreland was shut down by the governor, and it's a result of really that has led to all these further investigations and now some of these charges and arrests of people like Assemblyman Silver. So I think, you know, I don't know if it's disingenuous or maybe just a little late to the party again, but I think we don't need to hold the budget up. I think we still need to do our job as legislators to make sure we pass a budget that's responsible, that works for all New Yorkers, and I think we can do that and pass meaningful ethics reform at the same time.
Mm-hmm. So right now the budget hearings are going on for a month.
Correct.
Environmental, conservation, agriculture, health, one other one, transportation.
Yes.
Those have all met. And today will be education. So
correct.
These are all really big issues.
Very big issues. You think about education, obviously all that's going on, the proposed changes by the governor, mm-hmm. all that's gone on over the past year with Common Core, the gap elimination, and then transportation, which is a major issue, I think, in our conference and across the state with the $5 billion surplus, mm-hmm. there's a big push to spend a good portion of that on infrastructure. And I'm sure that came up in the hearings, and I'm sure that will come up in as we move forward with this process. The good news with the Assembly getting a new leadership in there is we can go forward and have the negotiation that we need to have to get a budget and make sure state government is working on behalf of the people and not being distracted by some of the drama. Mm-hmm. And the New York Post and Daily News headlines and such. So
exactly. You mentioned the surplus. I was speaking with Finance Chairman who leads all of these hearings.
Yes.
And he said that everyone has their own ideas of how to spend the surplus money.
Absolutely. I have mine. You know, and maybe some of those will actually end up being how we do it. But, you know, we all have, obviously, we're all elected and we all represent areas of the state. And we want to make sure that we're working on behalf of our constituents, and there might be a project within our district or areas that would help our district that we want to advocate for. And I think that's very important that everyone's voice gets heard. Truth be told, a lot of times you'll find there's a lot of other folks that agree with, you know, something that's important to your constituents is also important to other districts. It's not just one section of the state. So when it comes to infrastructure, I think we can all agree our infrastructure is in need of real maintenance and repair, and I think we have an opportunity to do that.
Right. Aside from the budget, you know, the Senate has really acted on a lot of stuff this year already.
Yep.
To help communities be protected from sex criminals.
Yep.
Issues for women, issues for equality,
yes.
issues for to help domestic violence victims.
Yep. Yep.
So really, aside from the budget, the Senate has been working really hard this year.
Yeah, we have. And I think that was right out of the gate. We felt there were a number of items that we could act on immediately that were important. Maybe some of these issues, I think, had dragged on last session.
Right.
And so I think there was a real sense from our in our conference and across the Senate, let's get these things taken care of. Obviously, the Assembly issue probably didn't help those things get passed in the Assembly, but now that that's rectified, hopefully, whether it's the women's equality, that can get passed into law.
Individual pieces.
The individual pieces. You talked about, we passed yesterday the street gang violence, which is going to help law enforcement combat gang violence, especially in inner cities, whether it's Niagara Falls or Buffalo or New York City. And we also passed the education tax credit, mm-hmm. Which I think is very important, and I know will be part of the negotiation process, but shows where the Senate is. And the Senate, it passed overwhelmingly in the Senate. Mm-hmm. So we have been busy. We've been passing, I think, good legislation on behalf of New Yorkers, and hopefully we continue to do that. And obviously the budget will be a big part of that.
Yep, and you'll be back next week to talk about this some more.
Same time, same channel.
So. All right.
Thanks, Julia.
Thank you. Thank you for watching Your Voice with Senator Robert Ortt. For additional information, ort.nysenate.gov.